First, I would like to thank the proposers of this prize, as well as the jury. And being a member of the European Society of Endocrinology for many years, I had the privilege to attend many of the Geoffrey Harris Prize lectures, so I understand quite well how important it is, this prize, and I feel indeed very honored. When you look at the list of people that previously received the prize, the list is quite impressive. In addition, two of the past recipients of this award are two very close friends of mine, namely Felipe Casanueva and Ezio Guigo. With Felipe Casanueva, he has been working for the last 30 years. We had many scientific discussions. Despite of that, we are still good friends, and I assume that we will be so for the future. In relation to Ezio, we have the opportunity to share common interests, and we were collaborating for many years because we probably share one common leitmotif, and is do science, but don't forget to enjoy doing science. And I am sure that we accomplished the second one. Going a little bit further, my training of the in neuroendocrinology was due over 7 years at Cardiff under the leadership of Maurice Scanlon. Maurice Scanlon is now retired since a few years ago, but he was really the one that I got my training in neuroendocrinology, and moreover, he dedicated all these years in Cardiff to make me feel at home, both he and all his family. So I would like to dedicate this lecture to him. Among other reasons, because although he was born in England, his ancestors were Irish, and he always felt very proud about his Irish roots. And finally, the talk I am going to give you today was based on the collaboration with a large number of people, of which I just would like to mention some of them. First, Miguel López and Rubén Nogueiras, that are PIs in our group, in our division, and that two very talented people that are really making a major impact in endocrine research. For many years, I have the privilege of working with Manolo Tenas and Pere in all the work related to the hypothalamus pituitary gonadalasis. And in addition, I've been working for all these years with Mar Malagón and Justo Castaño, also in Córdoba, Gemma Frubeck and Javier Salvador in Navarra. For many years, Vera Popovic and Dragan Misic, collaboration with them was very profound and very profitable in terms of getting new knowledge and clinical research. Also in Santiago, Clara Álvarez and Sulay Tobar were implicated in the things I am going to show you. And as stated before, Ezio Guigo, and this one, the youngest looking one in this slide is Felipe Casanueva, 30 years ago. So the talk I am going to give you today is understanding energy sensors, understanding neuroendocrine function. What is this title? Well, usually when I go to speak at neuroscience meetings, I always start with this slide. And most neuroscientists think the hypothalamus is not a very relevant set of neurons. They think that there are other more important ones. But I really think that this is the most relevant part of the CNS, because the hypothalamic neurons are the one that control very important biological functions: body temperature, growth, reproduction, lactation, water balance, food intake, emotional behavior. If you think all the important things in life, drinking, eating, sex, everything that is nice in life is controlled by the hypothalamus. Of course, there is other things like intelligence, but that does not ensure that you will be happier. The important things is the ones controlled by the hypothalamus. And we know that this control is asserted through a set of pituitary hormones that will drive the different pituitary axes, and that will translate in different biological effects. But if you take a closer look to these biological effects, growth, reproduction, lactation, thermogenesis, stress, there is a common theme to all of them, and that all of them needs energy to be able to come out. So in other words, if you want to grow either longitudinal or transversally, you need energy availability. For reproduction, you need to ensure that there is enough energy stored to have the pregnancy viable. For lactation, you need 50,000 to 80,000 kilocalories. Thermogenesis, you need energy just to expend heat. Stress, the same. So the common thing is that they all will depend on energy availability. And if we understand that all these processes are controlled by the hypothalamus, the question is how these hypothalamic neurons are able to know the energy availability that could be in a particular time to make all the axes working in a reasonable way. And we know this is important because if you get into a energy deprivation status, like fasting, we know that the hypothalamus will put into action a response to starvation with a decrease in energy expenditure, a decrease in the hypothalamus pituitary gonadal axis, a decrease in temperature, a decrease in immune function, a decrease in any process that will require energy disposal. And the reason that the hypothalamus is able to do that is to a large extent because it receives inputs for many different parts of the central and the peripheral signal systems, like the thyroid hormones, the glucocorticoids, the gonadal esteroids, insulin, leptin, and so on. But the general question that we and others have been trying to answer is how hypothalamic neurons sense energy availability. And the obvious answer, we'll see that they have energy sensors. But what are energy sensors? Really, there is no clear academic definition for energy sensors. So, but what we know is that there are many molecules that can act as energy sensors in a particular cell, in a particular system, in a particular moment. And when we talk about these energy sensors, we may be talking sometimes about, from a phylogenetical point of view, about the group C of the GPCRs that are able to bind amino acids, cations, sugars, and different molecules, the lipid glucose sensing molecules like specialized receptors and transporters, the L-amino acid sensing like FTO, different cation sensing mechanisms, caveolins, sirtuins, but really at the root of everything is when we talk about energy, we are talking about in most cell systems about the availability of ATP, and in practical terms, what it drives any biological process viable is the ratio of ATP to ADP or ATP to AMP. And when you are talking about the ratio ATP to ADP, ATP to AMP, you are talking about AMP kinase. That will be the efferent through which it will act and adapt in the cell. AMP kinase has been known for several years. That plays a major role in the cell biology of different tissues. Important in most of the metabolic relevant tissues like the muscle, the liver, the white adipose tissue, the pancreatic beta cells, the heart, but also at the hypothalamic level. And what is coming out from the work done in the last few years is that at the hypothalamic level, the AMPK mTOR energy sensors ratio is will act as a novel whole body energy sensor. And the reason to think so is because the AMP kinase is regulated by nutrients, but also by different peripheral hormones. And interestingly, there is a very strong interrelationship between AMP kinase and mTOR. Usually, when you go AMP kinase high levels, you will get a decreasing mTOR and vice versa. And this will drive basically food intake and all many other biological processes, such as glucose production, or lipid synthesis, and so on. So we knew that the AMP kinase mTOR is important, but the obvious question for a neuroendocrinologist is whether these energy sensors can be regulated by different neurotransmitters, by different hormones, and how they and what will be the biological relevance of that. And if we talk, for example, about energy balance, that is the first obvious question that one will try to answer when talking about energy sensors. We know for many years that food intake is mainly regulated by, on one side, by anorexigenic neuropeptides like alpha-MSH, or orexigenic neuropeptides such as NPY-AGRP. And the balance between alpha-MSH, NPY-AGRP will dictate whether food intake is increased or decreased. And we know that this is important because most of the signals, orexigenic and anorexigenic signals, like leptin and ghrelin, will add through all these neuropeptides. Well, okay, if in this very important PONC neurons or AGRP neurons, you just delete the energy sensor AMP kinase, what will happen? What will happen is that if you knock down AMP kinase in AGRP neurons, you will have a lean phenotype, and vice versa. If you knock out just the energy sensor, the AMP kinase in the AGRP neurons, you will get an obese and hyperphagic animal. So that illustrates that this, the thing that drives the relevance of these neurons, both the anorexigenic and the orexigenic neurons, is an energy sensor, AMP kinase. And in addition, what is coming out is that the AMP kinase in different sets of neurons is regulated by different signals. This is known for some years now. This is from Marta Corbonis, and what she did in this work was just to give peripheral ghrelin of a CB1 agonist, and she looked at AMP kinase in the hypothalamus. And what she found is that when you increase the activity of the endocannabinoid system or the give ghrelin exogenous, you get an increase on AMP kinase. In addition, we knew that from earlier work that ghrelin was also driving the increase in NPY and AGRP that will lead to his orexigenic effect. So basically recapitulating when we started to focus on this energy sensor, it was known that there was a ghrelin receptor at the hypothalamus, that there was an activation of AMP kinase, and that there was an activation of NPY and AGRP mRNA levels, and that will translate into an increased food intake. And it was already known that there were some transcription factors like FOSO, phosphocreb, or BSX that were involved in this activation. But as you can see, there are many empty boxes and many black boxes on all this diagram. And what we try is to fill all these questions or unanswered questions to have a clear idea of how the system was working. So the thing that we decided to focus was whether these changes in gene expression and in ghrelin effects at central level could be mediated by hypothalamic lipid metabolism. The reason to do this was based on the one hand in that we knew that ghrelin is a major regulator of lipid homeostasis. If you give ghrelin in a chronic administration to an animal, you get a marked increase in adiposity and in lipid synthesis. And we know that this is a central effect of ghrelin because you just give very low doses of ghrelin at central level that are not enough to add in the periphery, you get an increase on lipid synthesis. And this increase in lipid synthesis occurs even in imperfect animals. That means that they will receive ghrelin, but they will eat the same amount of control. Of control rats. So that means that in practical terms, the effect of ghrelin in lipid synthesis is unrelated to food intake, to increased food intake. And what happens in white adipose tissue, it also happens in the liver when you give, again, central ghrelin. And this effect of the ghrelin at the central level is largely independent on growth hormone. So there is clear evidence that ghrelin regulates lipid metabolism in the periphery. So we decided, in addition, there were some data suggesting that AMP kinase in many different systems can drive the lipid metabolism. When you phosphorylate AMP kinase, that will lead to the activation of AMP kinase. The phosphorylation of AMP kinase will phosphorylate ACC, and that will lead to inactivation of ACC. That will result in decreased levels of malonyl-CoA, decreased levels of the activity of fatty acid synthetase, and decreased synthesis of long-chain fatty acid. In addition, the low levels of malonyl-CoA is a major regulator of CPT1, and when you have low levels of malonyl-CoA, you will get high levels of CPT1, and vice versa. If you get increase in malonyl-CoA, you will get a decrease in CPT1 and decrease fatty acid oxidation. So basically, what we thought is whether this effect of ghrelin or AMP kinase will induce a change in hypothalamic lipid metabolism. And at that time, most people thought this would be unlikely because it was considered that hypothalamic lipid metabolism and neuronal lipid metabolism in general was not unregulated and was rather a constitutive function. To our surprise, what we first saw is that when you do a fasting experiment in an animal, you will get an increase on phospho-AMP kinase, you will get an increase on phospho-ECC, and you will get a decrease in malonyl-CoA. So suggesting that the changes in phospho-AMP kinase were modulating hypothalamic lipid metabolism. Okay. We knew that there was an effect on lipid metabolism during fasting, but as endocrinologists, we all know that during fasting there are major changes in the circulating hormones like leptin and ghrelin, and the question was whether these changes in AMP kinase during fasting were due to decreased leptin levels or increased ghrelin levels. And the answer to this question is that the changes are mostly mediated by ghrelin, and we know that because when we gave ghrelin as a central level, what we found is the same that during fasting, an increase on phospho-AMP kinase, an increase on phospho-ECC, and a decrease in malonyl-CoA levels. And in addition, if we do a fasting experiment in animals that with genetic ablation of the ghrelin receptor, the changes in fatty acid synthesis at hypothalamic level disappear. So, indicating that the changes at hypothalamic level are in the ghrelin and ghrelin receptor mediated. Okay, that is very nice. It shows that the hypothalamic lipid metabolism can be modulated by ghrelin, but the question is how relevant is in biological terms these changes in hypothalamic lipid metabolism? And to answer that question, what we decide is to act on this pathway at two different levels. What we decide is to silence the activation of phospho-AMP kinase using adenovirus with a dominant negative mutant of AMP kinase or acting at a later stage at the CPT1 level. When we inactivate the activation of AMP kinase by giving this dominant negative mutant in a specific population of neurons in the BMH, what we found is that the orexigenic effect of ghrelin disappeared or was markedly reduced in animals in which AMP kinase at the BMH was silenced. And this indicates that this AMP kinase phosphorylation was important, but the other thing that we wanted to be sure is that these changes in lipid metabolism were also relevant in terms of the biological effects of ghrelin. So what we decided is to go to the end of this signaling pathway, in particular to CPT1, and block CPT1 to see whether a similar effect could be observed in this setting. When you give ghrelin, you get a decrease in malonyl CoA, you get an increase on CPT1 because it's under regulation by malonyl CoA. But if you block this increase in CPT1 by giving a pharmacological inhibitor of CPT1, tomosir, what you will get is a similar effect to when you silence phosphoamp kinase. So, in other words, what this was saying is that the ghrelin effect on food intake was mediated by all this pathway. Later work by Thomas Horvath showed that confirmed this pathway, and in addition, he indicated that this mechanism was also depending on mitochondrial UCP2. And further work from us and others has shown that upstream of AMP kinase, there are other energy sensors like SIRT1 and also P53 that appears to play a major role in the activation of phosphoAMP kinase. So basically, what is coming out is that the orexigenic effect of ghrelin is mediated through different energy sensors. This scheme is under continuous development. For example, in addition to this mitochondrial effect, that now we know that is mediated by one of the isoforms of CPT1, CPT1A, now we know that there is another isoform that is mostly related to ceramides and ER stress, and I will come to that later on. But this is more than a fish photo, is just a dynamic model that we are working in order to be more precise and trying to unmask different players in this pathway. So, okay, that's okay. That shows that energy sensors are important in terms of energy homeostasis, but what happens in terms of pituitary hormone secretion? That is one thing that neuroendocrinologists are always asking. Okay, if you do a similar experiment to the one I just showed you in relation to the ghrelin effects on food intake, and instead of looking at food intake, you look at growth hormone release, what will happen? What will happen is that the effect of ghrelin can be blocked if you block AMP kinase. In this case, it's a pharmacological compound, compound C, that blocks AMP kinase selectively, and what it shows is that ghrelin-induced GH secretion or GHRH-induced GH secretion can be completely blunted by inhibiting AMP kinase at the hypothalamic level. In fact, this effect it also happens at pituitary level. If you do it in vitro, you will get also a complete blunting of GH responses to GHRH when you blunt or inactivate AMP kinase at pituitary level. And the opposite happens when you increase the activation of AMP kinase with ICAR, a compound that activates AMP kinase and that will increase GH responses to a maximal dose of GHRH. Okay, so this data showed that, okay, that ghrelin is important. It's mediating many other key effects through an energy sensors, through AMP kinase, but what happens with other gonadal axis and with other energy sensors? One of the most sensitive pituitary axis to changes in energy availability is suddenly the hypothalamus pituitary gonadal axis. And we know from many years ago that if you look at a physiological relevant event like pituitary puberty onset, puberty onset is mostly dependent on body weight. You need to reach a certain degree of adiposity, to reach a certain degree of increasing leptin levels before the hypothalamus pituitary gonadal axis becomes activated. How this happened, it has been something that has been looked in detail for many years, in particular by Manuel Tenas and Pere. And in this work, and what he did was a very simple experiment. We know that during food deprivation, if you submit animals to food deprivation, puberty onset will be delayed. So they will have decreased body weight, and that will translate in decreased uterine weight, estrogen levels, and decreased vaginal opening. You can rescue these food-deprived animals from dipuberty onset just by giving exogenous leptin. They will still have decreased body weight, but because you give leptin, you get an increased uterine weight, estrogen levels, vaginal opening, puberty onset. However, this positive effect of the leptin can just be blocked by blocking this energy sensor. If you block at central level and TOR in particular, all the effect of the leptin rescuing puberty onset will disappear. And animals will stay in a prepubertal status as long as central and TOR is inactivated. So what is saying is, this data is that energy sensors are mediating the activation of a physiological relevant event like puberty onset. Okay, what about other pituitary axes? Well, you know that for many years this is the classic hypothalamus pituitary thyroid axis, TRH driving TSH, TSH thyroid hormones, and most of the effects of thyroid hormones are considered to be asserted because circulating thyroid hormones at peripheral levels at in different peripheral tissues and that induce relevant biological events. We focus in one particular effect of thyroid hormones that is related to energy balance. And the interesting thing about thyroid hormones and energy balance, as happens in hyperthyroid patients, is that you get a very much increase in food intake. The subjects are hyperphagic. Still, they have decreased body weight. So, and this decreased body weight in a context of increased food intake is due that thyroid hormones lead to a marked increase in energy expenditure. And for many years, it was assumed that this increase in energy expenditure exerted by thyroid hormones was mostly due to the effect of thyroid hormones at peripheral level, in muscle, in brown adipose tissue, and so on. So we decided to address this experimentally with the aim of to characterize the effect of the thyroid hormones at hypothalamic level in terms of energy balance. And as shown here, in these animals, in hyperthyroid animals, because of the T4 administration, what you have is a marked increase in food intake. They are hyperphagic. And this hyperphagia is related to increase in AGRP, MPY, orexigenic neuropeptides, and decrease in PONC, and therefore decrease alpha MSH, or that is an anorexigenic neuropeptide. And the hypothesis we were testing whether in hyperthyroid there is an alteration in cellular sensors of energy availability leading to increased energy expenditure and increased food intake. And the answer to these questions, in particular in relation to AMP kinase and mTOR, is that AMP kinase is the energy sensor regulating energy expenditure and mTOR the one involved in the effect of thyroid hormones on food intake. And the reason to achieve this conclusion was based on the fact that in hyperthyroidism there is a marked increase in phospho mTOR and all the pathway activated by mTOR, like S6 kinase, and a decrease in phospho-AMP kinase. And the relevance of these changes in AMP kinase and mTOR were addressed directly by, in the first instance, by blocking mTOR with rapamycin, that is a specific inhibitor of mTOR. And when you give rapamycin to hyperthyroid animals, you decrease the elevated levels of mTOR and will translate into a decreased food intake. And this decrease in food intake is associated to a decrease, as expected, in MPY and AGRP, and an increase in alpha MSH. However, one of the main features of hyperthyroidism is that there is decreased body weight in spite of increased food intake. And to try to understand what was the mechanisms involved, we decided to see whether there was a direct effect in the brain, in hypothalamic neurons, that were driving the brown adipose tissue and the thermogenic program that leading to heat spend and therefore energy disposal. So again, we went back to this diagram and try to understand whether phosphoEMP kinase was involved in this mechanism. We knew that in hyperthyroidism there was a decrease in phosphoEMP kinase, and the first thing we did was, okay, this is the effect of the at hypothalamic level of increased levels of the thyroid hormones in the periphery. What will happen when we give directly thyroid hormones in specific neuronal populations of the hypothalamus? And what will happen is something very similar to the hyperthyroidism, that you will get a decrease in the energy sensor for phosphoEMP kinase and phospho-ECC and all the signaling pathway activated for that. So, in other words, what we were saying was that T3 was acting at hypothalamic level and through AMP kinase could be acting through this pathway. How relevant was the modulation of the AMP kinase in the BMH by thyroid hormones? Well, what we did, it was a similar experiment as shown before. In this case, what we did was genetic activation of AMP kinase in the hypothalamus because there is a decrease in AMP kinase in hyperthyroid rats. And what we saw is that when we did that, when we administer an adenovirus with constitutive activation of AMP kinase, what we were able is to reverse the changes in both the thermogenic program activated in adipose tissue and therefore the increase in energy expenditure. It was assumed that most of the effects of thyroid hormones in the brown adipose tissues were exerted directly, so the next question, okay, we have evidence for both mechanisms, which is the most important, the one of thyroid hormones acting in these hypothalamic neurons or the one of thyroid hormones acting directly on the brown adipose tissue? And to answer that, what we did is genetic inactivation of the thyroid hormone receptor just in this specific set of neurons in the BMH by using stereotactic delivery of a dominant negative for the thyroid hormone receptor. And what we found is that when you do that in animals treated with T4 peripherally, but if you knock down the thyroid hormone receptors in this particular set of neurons, you get a decrease in the thermogenic program in brown adipose tissues, indicating that many of the important effects of thyroid hormones on energy expenditure are just regulated specifically in the hypothalamus, specifically in this set of neurons. So in other words, what we were saying or we were proposing was that thyroid hormones released into the circulation could be acting in different tissues, but many of these effects will be mediated through actions at central level, through different energy sensors like AMP kinase and mTOR, regulating food intake in particular mTOR, regulating energy expenditure through AMP kinase, regulating other processes like glucose production and insulin resistance, and there are also evidence about cardiac function. So, in other words, the levels of thyroid hormones are regulated by the hypothalamus through the classic TRH-TSH thyroid hormone axis, but in addition to that, circulating thyroid hormones acting at hypothalamic level will be exerting many of their biological effects. And these effects are mediated or dependent on energy sensors. And this particular thing does not apply only to thyroid hormones, but it also can be found when you look at other peripheral hormones like estradiol. If you give estradiol to an animal, what you will get is a marked decrease on body weight. And this decrease is in part due to a decrease in food intake, but not only to a decrease in food intake, because if you compare with a perfect animal, you still have a major decrease in food intake. In body weight. So there is an effect on food intake, there is an effect on energy expenditure. And this effect of the estradiol, we know now that is exerted at hypothalamic level through a similar mechanism to the one I showed you for thyroid hormones. Basically, what it happens is when you give estradiol in the neurons of the ventromedial hypothalamus, what you will have is an increase on the thermogenic program on CP1 levels. When you look at the temperature of the brown adipose tissue, you will have an increase on the temperature and therefore in heat disposal, and that will contribute to decrease body weight. And we know this effect is mediated through AMP kinase, because estradiol also led to a marked decrease on phospho-AMP kinase, phospho-ACC, FAS, all the classic pathway. And that is mediated by the sympathetic nervous system, because when you do electrophysiology of the innervation of the brown adipose tissue, what you will find is that the effect of estradiol given directly in the ICV at central level will markedly increase the firing of the sympathetic nervous system. And that will translate in practical terms into increase in the thermogenic program, increase in UCP1, and this effect is specific in this set of neurons. If you do that inject estradiol in other set of neurons, like the arcuate, you will not find a similar effect. And again, this effect of estradiol, we know that is mediated through AMP kinase, because again, if you give an adenovirus with a constitutive activator of AMP kinase, you are able to reverse the changes in body weight to a large extent and in the changes in energy expenditure. So basically, what it shows is that circulating estrogens will reach the hypothalamus, will act through the ER alpha receptor, regulating AMP kinase, and this will, acting through the sympathetic nervous system, act on the brown adipose tissue. So basically, what this data show is that there is a canonical pathway that is regulating these energy sensors at central level, and that will impact on brown adipose tissue and energy metabolism. And we know that this is something that is much more complex, because now we know that in addition to this pathway, there is another relevant players, like the generation of ceramide that is related to ER stress, and that plays a major role in the regulation of energy homeostasis. And there is evidence for a link of all this pathway with ceramides and with ER stress, but I am not going to have time to get into detail into that. But in addition to what I just shown you, is that in addition to this relevance of hypothalamic AMP kinase at the hypothalamic level, AMP kinase and all the different energy sensors are also relevant in other tissues. Just a couple of examples. This is what happens when you inactivate AMP kinase at the duodenal level and give metformin, and what will happen is that the effect of metformin on hepatic glucose production is completely dependent on duodenal AMP kinase function. That was done by Tony Lang and published in Nature Medicine just this month, and what it shows is that duodenal AMP kinase is mediating the effect of metformin. And if you look at other regulators like nicotine is known to decrease body weight and also to lead to insulin resistance. And if you knock down AMP kinase in the Y adipose tissue, you abolish the effects of nicotine, not only on body weight, but also on insulin resistance. So what this is implying is a set of energy sensors acting in different tissues in a coordinated way will influence almost all the energy and metabolic homeostasis. The implications are going far beyond endocrinology, because now it's coming out that the AMP kinase mTOR ratio is acting as a checkpoint for cell fate in terms of cancer development, and that will this AMPK mTOR ratio will dictate whether the cell fate will be apoptosis, proliferation, and so on. And this is a recent review just addressing this issue. And also because we know that one of the among the many hallmarks of aging, like genomic instability, epigenetic alterations, and so on, one of the major features is the regulated nutrient sensing. And we know that this is something very much related to endocrine signals, because we know that many of the effects of aging, or some of the effects, are related to the growth hormone IGF-1 axis, and these effects are mediated by different energy sensors like SIRT1, AMP kinase, and mTOR. So in practical terms, what I was just trying to point out is that understanding energy sensors is helping us to understand neuroendocrine function, but that the repercussions are far beyond neuroendocrine function, but also to other hallmarks of daily life like aging or cancer. Thank you very much for your attention.